Hollywood and to all of West Hollywood and to all of you for being here tonight. Well, I had announced no time, marriage and politics. I will start by setting the topic of this talk within the framework of the research that I've been doing for more than 30 years now. This research has apparently dealt with objects and areas very distant from each other, from the forms of workers' emancipation to the regimes of identification of art, from the principles of democracy to the transformations of literature, from the theory of intellectual equality to the analysis of the forms of consensus built by the dominant apparatuses today, etc., etc. One main concern, however, makes the link between my investigation in those apparently distant areas. It's a common attention to the way in which those various practices and knowledges imply certain cartography of a common world. They all map a common world by determining forms of visibility of phenomena, forms of intelligibility of situations, modes of identification of events and of connection between events. By doing so, they also determine the ways in which subjects occupy this common world in terms of coexistence or exclusion, and they determine their capacity to perceive it, understand it, and act on it. I propose to name distribution of the perceptible or sensible, I don't know, this set of relationships between ways of being, ways of seeing, of thinking, and doing, which determines at once a common world and the way in which these or those subjects take part within it. The categories of time and temporality play a key role in that distribution. A narrative of time always defines two things at the same time. Firstly, it defines the framework of the world of experience that we share with everybody, that which is given as the now of our present, the way in which this present depends on the past or breaks away from it, whereby it allows or forbids this or that future. But it also defines ways of being in one's time, which means ways of being in tune or out of tune with it, to take part in the power of truth or error, inherent in its development. A narrative of time, thus, tells at once what a trend of times makes possible and what capacity those who belong in it have to seize all of the possible. This time construction is a fiction, but I must make a remark about the word fiction. A fiction is not the invention of an imaginary world. Instead, it is a construction of a framework within which subjects, things, and situations can be perceived as coexisting in a common world, and events can be identified and linked in a way that makes sense. Fiction is at work whenever a sense of reality must be produced. This is why politics and social science use fictions as well as novels or films. And the narrative of time is at the heart of the fiction that makes situations intelligible, which also means acceptable. In this sense, narrative of time always is a fiction about the justice of time, to recall a very old sentence, you know, of the Greek philosopher Anaximander. I felt it necessary to restage this dramaturgy of the justice of time to question the positivist notion of time that has been set to work in the dominant descriptions of our presence since the 1990s, since the collapse of the Soviet system. In more or less sophisticated versions, end of history, end of the grand narratives or else, those descriptions have set to work a clear-cut distinction between two forms of temporality. They said that now we are definitely done with a certain form of temporality, the form of temporality within which the course of time is determined by an immanent finality, moved by the power of an inner truth whose manifestation carries a promise of justice. What was said to remain thus was the bare reality of time, a time stripped of any inner truth and any promise of justice, and brought back its ordinary curse. There were several manners of understanding this ordinary curse. Our governments and dominant media saw it as the expert management of the present and of its immediate outcomes, when it is a matter of calculating the chances for prosperity offered by measures taken for the following months and destined to be verified in the following months. Disgruntled intellectuals, on the contrary, equated it with a gloomy post-historical age, characterized by the reign of the sole present, the reign of overwhelming consumerism, communication, and disbelief. But official optimism and disgruntled catastrophism shared the same vision of a present that had done with the great expectations and the lost illusions of a historical time moved by a promise of achievement. One of my compatriots coined the word presentism to name such a time. It soon turned out, however, that this absolute present had not so easily got rid of the passions engendered by the weight of the past and the anticipation of the future. The countries recently divested from the communist future were soon plagued by the revival of national narratives and ethnic and religious conflicts. The consensual policies of the Western parliamentary states fell prey to seemingly outdated narratives of fear caused by other races, people, and religions. And it eventually turned out that the expert, down-to-earth management of the free market itself demanded sacrifices in the present to build the future prosperity or simply avoid the impending catastrophe. It thus appeared that the simplistic opposition between the past illusions of history and the solid reality of the present conceals a division inside the present itself, a conflict about what is present and what a present is. It appears necessary thus to rethink the justice of time that was at the core of those so-called grand narratives and still makes effect in our present. My point is that it's not only a plot of expectation associated with the horizontal succession and linkage of events, but also a hierarchy of temporalities. To understand this point, and I require your patience, we must trace its genealogy far away in the past, by reaching back to the text that set in place in the Western world the rules of fiction, thereby imposing a pattern of the rationality of time which exceeds by far the boundaries of urban fiction. I mean Aristotle's poetics. The task of the poet, Aristotle said, is to construct a fiction, meaning an arrangement of actions according to necessity or plausibility. The poet constructs a causal plot whose progression is determined by two main relations, a relation between good fortune and misfortune, and a relation between ignorance and knowledge. This is how, in tragedy, for instance, the heroes shift at once from ignorance to knowledge and from good fortune to misfortune, witnessing a certain justice of time. Now, the important point about it is that by so doing, poetry proposes a pattern of rational linkage of events that Aristotle opposes to what he calls the history or the chronicle. The chronicle, he says, only tells how things happen one after another, while poetry tells how things might happen as a consequence of their rational possibility and rational linkage. In such a way, Aristotle created a model of rationality fitting as well scientific necessity and poetic plausibility. Now there is another important point about that form of rationality. This opposition between two forms of temporal linkage of events rested in a social hierarchy opposing two forms of lived times and two classes of human beings. The temporality of the causal connection fitted the condition of those men who were called active men, able to conceive great ends and to pursue them, or also to enjoy the time of leisure as an end in itself. The temporality of the chronicle fitted the condition of those men who were called passive, because they were enclosed in the time of the everyday, the time of the mere reproduction of life, where things happen one after another, allowing neither the ends of action nor the endlessness of leisure, but only the possibility of a pause for rest between two exercises of activity. In such a way, the horizontal connection of causes and effects rested on a vertical hierarchy of temporalities, the one that characterized the justice of Plato's Republic. Based on the preliminary condition that Plato formulated at the beginning of Republic Book II, that the workers stay all the time in their workshop because work doesn't wait. I think we must restage the play of this twofold hierarchy of kinds if we want to understand the logic at work in the so-called grand narratives, the modern narratives and of progress and possibly revolution, and the form of its survival and transformation and possibly reversal in our present. On the one hand, it can be said that those modern narratives have subverted the Aristotelian hierarchy of temporalities. They have made history the site of a rational linkage of events according to necessity. Even more, Marxism has located the matrix of the causal connection of human events in the obscure domain of the production of material life. By the same token, it subverted the tragic relation between knowledge and misfortune. The knowledge that the tragic heroes acquired at the end was the knowledge of the error that had caused their misfortune. Instead, the misfortune of capitalist exploitation created the conditions for the knowledge and the action, allowing to overthrow it. The historical evolution produced a science of the evolution that enabled the historical agents to turn the necessity of a system of domination into the possibility of its destruction. History, then, became the exemplary fiction of a conjunction between the unfolding of time, the production of knowledge, and the possibility of justice. But, on the other hand, the difference of temporality that had been dismissed by the affirmation of the rationality of the historical process soon reappeared in its very heart. The same process which paved the ways of the future also produced new forms of distance and belatedness. Not only did it throw some classes back into the past and made them act as a brake on the future, it also produced and reproduced in the everyday practice of work time and in the modes of seeing, thinking, and doing that it engendered, the veil of ideology that distanced people from the knowledge of the real movement of the historical forces. In such a way, the hierarchy of times that had been in the past a distance between two separate worlds became a distance between two ways of inhabiting the same world. The way of those who are enclosed in the immediacy of the everyday and the way of those who know the global connection within which it is included, the way of science. But by the same token, the scientific knowledge of the historical necessity was split from the inside. It was both the science of the conditions of possibility of the future and the science of its conditions of impossibility. The knowledge of the future destruction of a system of domination and the knowledge of its endless reproduction and of the endless delay of the destruction. My assumption is that this grand narrative of the historical necessity has not at all vanished in the so-called reign of the present. It is still there, I think. And what we see at work today, in fact, in the narratives of the present, the narrative that constructs the intelligibility of our present, is rather a redisposition of the relationships between necessity, possibility, and impossibility. It was rearranged in two forms, which both end up in a reversal of its logic, transforming the good fortune of a possible freedom into the misfortune of an eternal reproduction or a final catastrophe. Well, first, on the one hand, the capitalist and state domination simply took over the principle of the historical necessity and affirmed that the obedience to that necessity was the only way of the possible. But, of course, this possible was no more the rupture of the system of domination. On the contrary, the only good fortune that knowledge could promise was the lone possible, a lone possible that was strictly predicated on the good function of the existing order. But this law of the possible also entailed a new mapping of the possible and a new implantment of the common time and of its requirement. This is how historical necessity was renamed globalization, and it appeared that globalization was also a time oriented toward an achievement. The achievement was no more revolution, instead it was a triumph of the global free market. But this triumph also had its conditions. It also required sacrifices. It was not simply a matter of empirical adjustment to the ebb and flow of the market. It was a matter of adjustment between two kinds: the rational time of the global process of the capitalist production and distribution of wealth, and the empirical time of the individuals living in the temporality of the things that happen one after another. For instance, the time of work and the amount of pay, or the time of work and the time of retirement and pension. In the 19th century, Marx and Engels had stigmatized the artisans and petit bourgeois who stuck to outdated social forms and ideals, and thereby hindered the development of capitalism and of the socialist future that it prepared. At the end of the 20th century, the scenario was revised. The condition for the good fortune to come was the destruction of the outdated forms inherited from the past, such as labor codes, laws regulating the conditions of employment, healthcare and pension systems, public services, and so on. Those who broke the way to the future now were those workers who still stuck to those archaic things. This is how the social achievements won by past workers' struggles were renamed privileges, and the war was waged against those selfish, privileged people who protected their short-term interests against the long-term interests of the whole community. On this basis, many leftist intellectuals in my country, notably, brought the arguments of Marxist science to back the right-wing governments in their struggle against the so-called privileges of the past. The sense of historical necessity was still there, and the fact that it led no more to the triumph of revolution, but to the triumph of the free market, was a secondary consideration. So on the one hand, the narrative of historical necessity has been taken over and recycled by the managers of the order that was supposed to destroy. It is true, but there remains an other version of the narrative, a version that reaffirms itself as a critic of the capitalist order of time. But this critical version itself has been revised. It accuses not so much the injustice of the system as the ignorance of its victims, the inhabitants of the time, of the things that simply happen one after the other. The official discourse denounces them as ignorant people who are unable to fit the time of the globalized free market. The critical or so-called critical discourse makes the opposite diagnosis. It reproaches them for adapting themselves too well to the time of the free market and meeting its requirements either in the passive form of an internalization of its freedom, of the values of flexible personality, consumerist narcissism, and so on, or the active claim of libertarian values that paved the way to the reign of that freedom. On the first side, the critic of fetishism, consumerism, or the spectacle that have been concerned in the past with demonstrating the functioning of the capitalist machine to incite struggle against it, now targeted the so-called democratic individuals and made them responsible for the production of the system. On the other side, the collective forms of anti-authoritarian revolt were accused of building the modes of subjectivation required by the forms of capitalist development. Such was, for instance, the argument made by an influential book called The New Spirit of Capitalism. According to its authors, the rebellious young students of 1968 had substituted for the tradition of social criticism a new form of so-called artistic criticism, established on individualistic values such as autonomy and creativity. In such a way, they said, they had given to capitalism the means to regenerate itself by integrating those values of autonomy and creativity in the new forms of flexible management. In such a way, critical thinking ends up lining the official discourse by ceaselessly showing how the system endlessly reproduces itself and absorbs any form of subversion within its own dynamism. This circular logic lends itself to two scenarios. On the first side, there is the scenario of repetition, the eternal denunciation of the eternal reproduction of the necessity. On the second one, there is the scenario of the catastrophic spiral, in which a humanity of flexible individuals and narcissistic consumers is said to precipitate itself towards the final judgment day when it will atone for all its sins against all of time. In short, the time of the causal process involving the possibility of the rupture has been split in two times, but both cancel this possibility, a time of eternal reproduction and a time of final catastrophe. So it is that the logic of the judgment of history has been redistributed according to two dramaturgies. The first one brings the tribunal of history back to the knowledge of the remedies necessary to keep our societies alive. The second one makes of this life itself the scene of the last judgment. Both dramaturgies fit the dominant scenario of necessity today, namely the scenario of the crisis. In March time, the economic crisis was a sign of the irrationality at the heart of capitalist rationality, a sign that pointed towards its impending death. Today it works exactly in the opposite direction. The crisis has become the very basis of its rationality. On the one hand, crisis is just another negotiation. It is the so-called unavoidable reality that dictates the destruction of all the forms of belatedness that are opposed to the law of the free, of this law and scientific necessity. This identification implies that behind the economic sense of the notion of crisis, its first meaning, the medical one, be reactivated. But this reactivation itself implies a distortion. In the old medical tradition, the crisis was a well-defined moment. It was the final moment of the illness, when the doctor had done all he could do and let the sick person, to confront the final battle, wherein you know they would either die or come out cured. In the new scenario, however, it had become the exact contrary. It's no longer the moment of resolution, but the pathological state itself. The economic crisis has been turned into a permanent state of illness of society or even humanity. And this chronic disease gives all the power to the character that used to lead the place in the ancient scenario, namely the doctor. If the crisis denied the state of the world, it is clear that what it calls for is the attentive and interrupted care of the doctor. But to say the truth, those doctors are nothing more than the state authorities and the financial powers that manage its state of affairs, named crisis, which goes back to saying that the disease named crisis is nothing more perhaps than the robust health of a system of exploitation. But to give the name of crisis to that normal process, allows to hollow out the gap between the human who live in the pathological time of succession, wherein crisis means the loss of employment, the lowering of the salary, or the loss of welfare benefits, and those who live in the time of silence, when crisis designates both the overall necessity known by silence and the illness of the ignorant people that must be treated. This confirms both the science of the scientists and the ignorance of those who are ignorant, but also the guilt of the latter, whose illness consists in their incapacity to adapt their time to global time. So I think we have not exited the time of the grand narratives, the narrative that constructs the adhesion to domination, or those narratives which claim to contest it, remain caught within the same fictional logic, the logic of historical necessity itself founded upon a hierarchical partition of temporality. All the authorities of the state, finance, media, and science are ceaselessly working to produce these gaps, but render the same individuals at once dependent to the justice of global time and constantly at fault with respect to this time. They work at reproducing both the fiction of global necessity and the difference between those who live within the time of knowledge and those who live within the time of ignorance. The official discourse and the critical discourse, the fiction of progress and the fiction of decline, go round in the same circle. If we want to get out of the circle and rethink the justice of time, I think we may have to change our focus and shift from the consideration of the horizontal dimension of progress or decline to the issue of the vertical partition of times that sustains it. To this purpose, I would like to go back over some aspects of the justice of time that I met while working on the forms of workers' emancipation and the theory of intellectual emancipation. Well, the first thing that I learned on this way can be very simply spelled out. The most radical injustice suffered by those who are submitted to the injustice of exploitation is the injustice of not having time, the injustice of the partition of temporalities. For this partition doesn't only entrap them in the material constraint of work, it also gives them a soul and a body, a way of occupying time and space, of seeing, speaking and thinking adapted to that constraint. This is what I learned first in reading a text that I commented several times in various contexts because it was determined in my way of understanding what emancipation means and how it deals with time and space. I'm talking here of the narrative of the day at work, wrote in the 1840s by a French carpenter named Goni. As he describes it, the work day is not simply the exercise of an activity. It is also, in the strongest sense of the word, an occupation, a way of being in time and space. On the one hand, it is the quotidian necessity that constantly reproduces the division of temporality, which is the division of times of life. But it is also the concrete flowing of hours and minutes, one after another, wherein a possible gap can be played out against that normal reproduction. The possible work of the body and the mind that regains against the constraint of space, the deviation of a gaze that leads thought elsewhere, or against the constraint of time, an inner division of a thought that makes the body work faster or slower, or in any case, out of tune in a different way. In my book, Proletarian Nights, I analyzed the dramaturgy of the house constructed in this manner by Goni, and the way in which the relation of the movements of thought to the movements of the body constructed a complex logic of gaps between a time of renewed servitude and a time of acquired liberty, two times which occupy the same time. But of course, the first recovery was the very decision to put into narrative this time, which by definition had always been the time excluded from the order of narrative, the time where nothing happens. And of course, Goni's narration was a fiction too. The carpenter did not recount, you know, as a reporter, his work day. He constructed a fiction. He turned the time wherein, by definition, nothing new ever happens, in a time wherein, at any moment, a multiplicity of micro-events of adhesion or refusal happened. Therefore, the work day was not merely the microcosm where science could recognize the law of a system of production. It became a time of redistribution of times. That redistribution was itself the expression of a previous one in order to write The carpenter had to take the time, but he had not. By turning the time of pause, the time of rest, destined to restore the forces of the worker, into the time of leisure, belonging to those who are not subject to the constraint of work. So before being a line stretched between past and future events, time is a milieu, a form of life. This is what could be learned from the narrative of the work. From this point on, it was possible for me to think of a justice of time, but that is not entrusted to the global process of the march of time, but that operates, on the contrary, as an inner redivision of time, as a production of gaps which are not manifestations of ignorance and belatedness, but positive ruptures away from the normal knowledge of the hierarchy of temporalities. Each of those moments that come one after another is at once the point where the reproduction of the partition of time passes, and the point of a possible gap and a possible redivision. The moment is not the time of the ephemeral opposed to the long duration and to its causal linkage. It is the power to engender another time, which redistributes the ways on the scale of destinies. That this power of the moment engendering another line of time is also what I found in the theory of intellectual emancipation, elaborated by Joseph Jacoteau, that I analyzed in my book, Ignorant Schoolmaster. Jacoteau showed that the whole logic of the education system rested in a certain manner of fictioning the point of departure, a pedagogical fiction which was at once a fictional construction of the whole social order, a fictional construction of social inequality. The master, he said, is supposed to take the child in a primitive state of ignorance and to make him or her rise step by step in a good order the ladder of knowledge by way of his explications. But this ordered way from ignorance to knowledge and from inequality to equality in good order is in fact the indefinite reproduction of the belatedness of the pedant, the indefinite reproduction of inequality. Instead, the time of emancipation presupposes that there is no right point of departure, no state of ignorance. The process of learning has already started, and a new emancipated way of learning can start from anywhere at any moment. Everything is in everything, the currently tautological and stupid statement made by Jacques, means that you can find in everything, the something from which you can construct your own intellectual adventures, your own way of linking a knowledge to a new knowledge, according to the principle everybody has an equal intelligence. This idea of the moment, whose power of expansion creates another line of temporality, exceeds by far the context of an educational myth. It concerns all forms of social relationships and social activities. It is also, for instance, the power that characterized the revolutionary days, where the people of the passive main forgot the work that doesn't wait and left their workshop in order to affirm within the streets their participation in a common time. While in a famous text, Walter Benjamin saw this time as a powerful explosion of the temporal continuum, symbolized for him by the man who, during the Paris Revolution in July 1830, is said to have shot out the street clocks in order to stop time, like Joshua stopping the sun. Well, of course, it is a mere fantasy, but that did not happen. And anyway, what these kinds of days produced is rather than this shock, the opening of another time, where the evidence that structures the temporal order of time is erased, where the distribution of the possible is reconfigured. and with it the power of those who inhabit time. It's a new common time constructed out of the breaches made within the dominant order of time. This power of the moment that engenders another kind of events and another form of linkage between events has had a contradictory destiny in modern times. On the one hand, the Marxist revolutionary tradition sent it back to the side of the bad time, the time of the ephemeral moment and of the imaginary futures, opposed to the temporality of the action predicated on the knowledge of the laws of history. On the other hand, the rupture within the scale of time has become the principle of another revolution, the modern revolution of the art of fiction called literature. This revolution very precisely called into question the Aristotelian opposition between the time of succession and that of causal connection. I'm thinking here of the text of a text by Virginia Woolf entitled Modern Fiction, a text written in 1922, that denounces the tyranny of the plot and pits against these false sequences of cause and effect the truth of these atoms of time that ceaselessly fall into our mind. While one has often assimilated this rupture of the temporal order in fiction with the biased elitist position of literature that takes it time to detail the delicate moods of idle bourgeois characters. But this would be to forget that its rupture of the temporal scale was first of all a dismissal of the opposition between two human categories. The time of the atoms that fall one after another is a common time of the so-called active human beings and the so-called passive human beings. It is a time that Virginia Woolf's heroine, Mrs. Dalloway, shared with all those anonymous lives that cross her path in the street. It is a time of all those leaves who strive to shatter the order that keeps them enclosed on the wrong side of the barrier of time. Behind the day of Mrs. Dalloway, preoccupied to preparing for her evening party, one can feel the presence of an overday described in an other novel, Robert's Madame Bovary, the day of the peasant's daughter, Emma Bovary, watching behind her windows the always identical flow of the time of hours, and attempting to invent a history for herself that would shatter the repetition of this order. And behind the day of Emma Bovary, we can also perceive the day of the carpenter Goni, transforming his house of servitude into a house of freedom. Modern literary fiction put into its heart this time where the struggle of fortune and misfortune can happen at any hour of the day, a time made of a multiplicity of micro-events whose democratic coexistence and interpenetration is counterposed to the time of subordination which characterizes traditional fiction. But it also means that modern literary fiction created out of the time regained by the men and women doomed to the everyday, its own time, the new texture of the narrative, while it abandoned its characters to the misfortune of those who vainly want to have the time that they have now. I think today it could be useful to rethink this game of three between the narrative of the global process, the temporality of the moments of emancipation, and the time of literary fiction. In order to exist, the grand narrative of necessity in these two versions of the management of the lone possible or the final catastrophe. I particularly think it can help us rethink today the possible connection between the lifetime of the individuals and the moments of collective affirmation. It seems necessary, I think, to call into questions the analysis that are in vogue regarding the conformity of the so-called flexible individuality or neoliberal subjectivity with the law of a global process from now on exerting its mastery over throughout one's whole lifetime. Contemporary experience of work and life rather impose the experience of a discontinuous time a time made of bumps and holes, incessant passages from employment to unemployment, the development of part-time work positions and all forms of intermittency, the multiplication of those who belong both to the time of salaried work and to the time of education, to artistic time and to the time of small day jobs, those who were trained for a specific job and are employed in a completely different one, etc., etc. This fragmented time, perhaps, puts back on the current agenda the problematic of emancipation, that of a conflict, whose subject is the occupation of the moments, and whose target is the geographical division of temporality, the division between activity and passivity within the time of work, and the division between pause and leisure within the time of inactivity. This war for the reappropriation of what we can call a polytime, a fragmented time, can perhaps be the principle of a new linkage between individual and collective ruptures. This is at least what was at stake several years ago in France, with the strike of those that were named intermittents of the spectacle. In the beginning, this strike was concerned, you know, with the threats regarding the unemployed workers' compensation, you know, for those artists whose time is split between visible hours of work and the invisible time of work necessary for preparing it. But the curse of the strike revealed two opposing tendencies. A part of the actors in the movement wanted to maintain the specificity of their categorical demands, while another group wanted to, on the contrary, generalize their demands. They wanted to show that this intermittent time of artists perhaps was the general form toward which the precarious time of work now tended. And they also wanted to shed light on a new form of struggle against this condition of precariousness, the formation of a common time constructed within a new world on the partition of times. It can be interesting, I think, to analyze the recent forms of collective movements around the world from this point of view, from the Arab Spring to the Spanish Indignados movements, or the Occupy movements from Madrid to New York or Athens to Istanbul. Their importance has often been questioned in the name of a simple division of times, pitting against those spontaneous protests and their ephemeral existence, the time of long-term strategies, which links moment together according to the connection of means and ends. But this simple opposition leaves out the much more complex game of the division and sharing of times. It is precisely this game that is summarized by the very word occupation. This word occupation, very simple word in a way, in effect goes back to an affair of justice incarnated within the distribution of spaces and times. The justice of the Platonic Republic consisted of a distribution of occupations, directing each one to remain within the necessary time and space that suited their specific activity. It is against that justice or injustice that the factory workers of the 20th century occupied their factories, in order to transform the place of exploited work into the space of the collective power of the workers. Today, in a certain way, it can be said that the park or the street takes the place of the factory for a population of workers that are dispersed by the times and spaces of their jobs, and obliged to create, within the circulation of urban spaces, the place for a common time. But it's also the place where the various fragmented experience of times can be assembled. Multiple experiences of dispossession and recovery of time that are characteristic of the present time of precarious work. A present that is common to the small vendor on a Tunisian street whose suicide incited the jasmine revolution in Tunisia, and to the graduate students without jobs in the occupied parks of New York or Madrid. Occupying as an anonymous people the indeterminate site of circulation, while the workers of yesteryear occupied the work site that had already gathered them together, This is perhaps also a way to place back within the center of the conflict the notion of the distribution of spaces. It's not indifferent that one of the most significant movements of occupation in the last years, that of Taksim Square in Istanbul, started out as a conflict concerning the future use of the site. It was a question concerning the transformation of a site of leisure, open to everyone for indeterminate use, into a military building and a shopping mall. But it is also significant that the occupation of class places was also the time of an encounter between multiple temporal experiences, which were also translated into multiple forms of action on time. It is as if the new forms of collective action, instead of the strategic traditional temporalities, were implementing those forms of the coexistence of temporalities that the literary evolution has pitted against the run-out tyranny of the plot. The temporality of the occupation is a conjunction of several forms of the recovery of time. There are the interruption of the normal course of the hours and activities that was symbolized by the, for instance, by the performance of the standing man at Taksim Square, standing silent for 8 hours in facing the Ataturk Cultural Center. A time of interruption that is also one of those new forms of encounter between the time of the artistic performance and that of political action. There are forms of organization of a time of collective discussion and construction of agendas at removed from the form of public life organized by the state. There are the forms of organization of the daily life of the collective gathered in the occupied streets and parks. And there is the effort in order to install in the long term those moments of reconstruction of a common time by creating forms of alternative organization of the life of the community, from the system of production of goods all the way to the transmission of knowledge or the circulation of information. We know how the recent movement have brought back to our attention these alternative forms of the organization of time of life that played such a big role in past workers' movement as the form of future anticipated in the present. Of course, those movements also brought back into question the contradiction of those forms of anticipation. But my problem today was not to designate the right or wrong models of the future. It was simply to invite us to re-examine the dominant model that today serves for us to think the relations between the historical flow of global time, the forms of domination, and the time of our lives. I propose to operate a double displacement in relation to those dominant models. Against the analysis that claim that we have exited the time of the grand narrative in favor of the time of the low possible, I attempted to demonstrate how the narrative of historical necessity continues to structure the dominant time at the price of transforming the promises of liberation into disenchanted analysis of subjection or into prophecies of a final catastrophe. I reminded, secondly, how this narrative of necessity itself was rooted within a hierarchical division of time that it relentlessly reproduced. I tried to show how another thought of time and of its possibility could be drawn from those forms of struggle as well as those forms of narratives that have called this hierarchical division of time into question and that continue to do so today. Thank you for your patience.
Yes. Is there a microphone? Or?
Okay.
Thank you. Well, thank you for this very complex lecture and for recording Walter Benjamin as someone other than a melancholic philosopher. Yes, the formulation of the time and the now had a lot to do with revolution, but the protagonist of that moment for Benjamin, the time and the now as a Molotov cocktail, right, is not the revolutionary activist, is the idler, is ultimately the gambler, the idler, anybody associated with the figure of Baudelaire. And what I gather from Benjamin, I seem to gather from you, is something very interesting, and this notion that there is a form of emancipation only possible once we acknowledge the possibility of emancipation born from failure, from the broken. And that is not crisis, at least not in a neoliberal manufactured sense. It's the old sense of crisis that you find in Greek tragedy. The word krisis, which was a turning point in the plot. That's what the crisis, the etymology of the word crisis is. But in any case, for us today, to engage in the possibility of a crisis predicated on acknowledgement of a radical failure, almost in a Kafkian sense, the luminosity of failure, is something no longer so tragic. It's tragic, it's comic. But I'm interested in what kind of encounter which you proposed. You say something about encounter. What kind of encounter, what kind of subjectivity would that require? Because it requires something profoundly stranded. It requires something.
Of course, it's a big issue, and I cannot pretend to give an answer now. And usually, you know, when you answer questions, in fact, you displace it to try to make it your own question. So this is what perhaps what I will make part of it with your question. You know. So what I understand, you know, for my part, you know, in your question, you know, well, about the gambler and the idler and about failure, well, is a way of rethinking out of the old opposition, you know, between activity and passivity. So meaning thinking that, and I think for me, this is what was it. So something very important, you know, in the history of emancipation, the fact, the way in which emancipation was linked with, I would not say failure for my part, but it's my own choice, you know, the way in which it was, it was connected with a certain way of, a certain form of inaction, of diversion, you know, from a certain logic. Precisely, you know, of the distribution of the roles, you know, between those who are active and those who are passive, you know. So this also, which also means precisely, you know, thinking time, not thinking time from, you know, as this kind of line, you know, of causes and effects, you know, between the past and the future, and between our decision and the outcomes of our decision. Not but thinking time precisely from, well, we can say the crisis, but for me, you know, I think I have a less dramatic, you know, view of history, you know, and so I would not say, you know, thinking about the point of the crisis, but well, because between but from the point, you know, of a distance or of a gap. So I would prefer, you know, to think in terms of gap, than in terms of failure. And so I think really, well, it's a problem of rethinking subjectivity in this way, you know, the thinking of a form of subjectivity that oversteps, you know, the old oppositions, you know, between activity and inactivity, activity and passivity. Really, a way of thinking the time, thinking time really from the middle, you know, and from what can be at the same time, you know, well, gained and lost, you know, in a moment, you know. I always, and also to recall your failure, you know, I'm not against failure, you know. I also remember, you know, of course, a sentence, you know, by Wilke, you know, that was very important for me, I should say, but to lose is also ours, you know. So to lose is also ours, but to lose is not only what could be defeated, you know. It's to take some kind of distance with a certain period of time.
This is a big question. We're all teachers and students, and we wouldn't be here, or have been, at some time. Are we workers, first of all? How would you apply what you just said to our situation? I don't see a lot of statements.
Well, but well, you know, it's an old. It's not a question, in fact, you know. Well, you know, in the 60s, well, you know, when I was young, you know, around the 68, you know, when somebody, you know, started, you know, speaking, there was somebody, of course, telling, but there is no point discussing here, you know, or there is no point in what you are saying, you know. Try to go to the gate of the factory and ask the workers what they think, you know, what you are saying. So, you know, we think that there is a this is, you know, this kind of terrorist, you know, aspect, you know, of the question. So my point is... The point is not to know how many people, you know, are working, you know, in factories, you know, of this kind, you know, places here, you know. Well, the point is what we mean by work. But my point is also precisely, you know, that we are, you know, confronted with transformation of the very notion of work today, you know. And this is the point I try to make, you know, by thinking, for instance, but of by mentioning this experience of precarious, you know, work, but it's common, you know, to all kinds of jobs, you know, and all kinds of social conditions. Well, I don't know exactly, you know, what the real question is. But yes, probably, yes, I think we are, all of us are, in a way, you know, our work, meaning that we are occupying a certain place in society, a certain place in the distribution of role, you know. And the point is, we are in a situation, you know, in which precisely the traditional section of roles is more or less disturbed, you know, subverted by the very game, you know, of the dominant order, you know. And the point is, what do we make, you know, ourselves of this fact, you know, that there is this fact of a kind of a fragmented time or holy time, you know. And what do we make, you know, out of this time? So because what I try to do, you know, by referring to my own work of workers' emancipation, and you can say that it's the past, you know, and there are no more workers, which is absolutely not true. But many people feel that there are no more workers, you know, so probably they have to go to some to the chat, you know, the idea that but you know, old factories of the old fashion, you know, still exist, but that's not the point, of course. But the point, the point is, you know, we have this redistribution which urges us to rethink exactly what we are doing, you know, in our role, you know, our role of teachers, our role of students, our role, you know, of person, you know, who occupy this or that kind of position in the existing social order. And I think it's a time, perhaps, this is what I try to suggest, you know, and I don't want to claim some kind of new fantastic, you know, movement. No, that's not my point. But I think, yes, I think there is, we are in a moment, you know, where we can think of a certain convergence, let us say, between a way of between the production of distances, the production of gaps, you know, and certain form of gathering, certain forms of collectivization of experience.
If I could add something, that there is in a way that some element of particular understanding of emancipation and temporality that you put forward here, even if not in the classic sense of, you know, having industrial workers in the room, but in Southern California, you have this event on a Tuesday night in which it's not mandatory for any rationalistic understanding of the temporality of anybody in the room, not even for credits, course credits, that we are here and debating and talking about these issues. It's a disruption. We are using the time we don't have.
Some hypothesis to offer about the occupied Hong Kong, because here we have a series of temporalities, of scattered temporalities at stake, and also the people in Hong Kong have even the feeling maybe they are being occupied by mainland China, leaving a temporality that is Western derived because we're from Hong Kong, but also being attached to the form of temporality that mainland China is experiencing right now, having a different form of growth and access to capitalism. And I'm wondering if you have something else to say about that. Thank you.
Well, you know, I've never been in Hong Kong, so, you know, I cannot really add up. I know, of course, about what happened in Hong Kong, but on the news, as many people. So I think at the same time, What I think interesting is the way in which there is this, let's say, this form, you know, of occupation, this form of occupation, which in fact takes place in very different regimes, you know, it can take place, it takes place, you know, at the same time, you know, in Egypt, you know, and there's a dictatorship, it takes place, you know, in our so-called democratic countries, you know, it takes place. Well, it takes place in a place like Hong Kong, you know. Well, at the same time, you know, it is a kind of implementation of a global movement, you know, of constituting precisely people of the anonymous, you know, against, you know, the people that is managed by the state, the people that is constituted, you know, by the domination of the financial powers. But at the same time, of course, there is something specific in Hong Kong, something specific because, Hong Kong is very specific place, you know, it's a matter of confronting, you know, this regime that doesn't recognize, you know, democracy, you know, as a normal form, you know, of discussions, as a normal form of collective life. So I think there is at the same time this kind of this word trouble of a certain form, you know, of protest, you know, against the dominant order of the world, and there is at the same time this very specific movement, you know, well, about democracy, you know, in this country, which is now under the rule of the Chinese Communist Party, in a way, but no, not directly.
Yes, thank you. I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit on something that I thought was really provocative and interesting for me, and that was the way in which the pedagogy that you elucidated in Ignorant Schoolmaster, you said today, could perhaps engender, or it presupposes, or it would exist in a kind of temporality that is different from, you know, the dichotomy of the two temporalities you've talked about. And one other question that's part of this is that, first of all, I was wondering whether your two temporalities, it seems to me, are a little bit perhaps artificial. I'm an ex-academic and I in philosophy, and it seems to me that, for instance, a phenomenological or a Hegelian kind of, you know, temporality might be a solution that kind of surpasses the dichotomy of the Benjamin kind of catastrophic temporality versus the scientific or the ordinary kind of time occupational, you know, moment after moment, etc. temporality. But another part of this is that I think, given my trajectory out of academia into working in technology and technology education, I'm wondering whether the moment of crisis that can kind of finesse those two temporalities and break through, I love that you mentioned the pedagogy, but also might not be coming from the ability of technology to put in the hands of people all over the world a different kind of way of relating to the everyday world, such that the old-fashioned kind of Marxist 19th, 20th century working at the factory is no longer what the kind of time or place in which most people engage, but rather many, many, many people who are workers are working in a kind of space-time which is at their computer, worldwide, you know, processing things on like a global time way, and it's very, very different. And I think that kind of work relationship is going to quantitatively overcome the sort of factory model that is representative of the kind of time that you talked about in your early description of the two times. So, you know, this is kind of a confused question, but rather, is there a third time? Could you elaborate a little bit about, you know, your model of pedagogy and how that relates to that third kind of time? And doesn't, can we look for that third time in at least the beginnings of it in a kind of Heideggerian phenomenological time order? And is perhaps the new way of working in the world, the tech workers, not an instantiation of that kind of time?
Well, it's I have only big questions today, so make big answers. I think that there are several points. I did not exactly, propose something like a third time. I rather propose, you know, a way of really. Disrupting, you know, this hierarchy of temporality, which is not specifically linked, you know, with the fact of working in a factory, you know. And I think that really, you know, the pattern of temporality, you know, is reproduced, in fact, you know, every day, and even, you know, if, you know, modern, postmodern, it's a condition, you know. If you think, for instance, you know, of the way our government function, of the way our media function, you know, they function really, you know, as pedagogues that, you know, day after day, at the same time, you know, give us the description of the world, give us all the information on the world, and at the same time show us that we are still related, you know, but we are unable to catch up with this time. So, for instance, you know, in my country, you know, it's quite impossible, you know, on TV to have any information, you know, without having two or three specialists, you know, explaining us, you know, what is about, what happened, and even for things, you know, that need no comment at all, you know. There are always both comments, both specialists, you know, coming from very, you know, well-known, you know, institutions, you know, that tell us, which means that if they tell us, they explain us, this means that we will not understand otherwise. This means that this reproduction, you know, of the distance, it is still produced every day. But it is true, you know, but from my point of view, what happened, what is interesting, you know, with the new technological means, perhaps it's not so much the production of a different kind of working time, you know, as it is, well, the, the difference precisely in this relation of temporality. You know, we all know how in a many, you know, recent movement precisely, you know, the internet, you know, allowed, you know, protesters in a way, you know, to go faster at the information system, you know, in recent movements, I think it's important in a way, you know, the way in which new technology, produce a kind of new war of time. You know. So I don't think so. The point is not, you know, really the creation of some kind of. It is rather, as I try to say, the production of a multiplicity, you know, of distances, of gaps. You know, that means that precisely the dominant kind, you know, is not so easily able, you know, to structure, you know, the lifetime of the individuals and the possibilities, you know, for the individuals, you know, to get in touch with each other. Well, as we know, well, you know, I can speak all the time. But
I have a real question. It's going to be displacing the question from the question of time to the question of space. Okay. You have shown interest in the past on the Saint-Papier movement, you know, the general movement that immigrants are part of, mostly in European and countries in the U.S. Do you think your framework, the framework that you put forward today, that you elaborated today, that combines the pseudo end of the grand narrative, meaning in spatial times, that would be this grand narrative would be the end of the nation states. You know, so borders are no longer we disappear, but then they didn't disappear and they are kept on the condition that are used to keep in place a hierarchy of space. That is, the horizontal understanding of space that was supposed to be overcome by globalization is kept in place on the condition that it establishes a hierarchical division of space. Is there something there in the logic of emancipation that you identified in spurts in places such as Egypt, the Occupy, on the Nados movement, etc., that could be also used to trace the way in which the immigrants are also kind of engaging in an emancipatory struggle by questioning this hierarchy of space?
Well, it's a problem, and of course, you can have opposite interpretation of the same of the same movement, but yes, first, you know, I think that, you know, the narrative, you know, about globalization, no more borders, no more nation states. It's really a lie, you know. Nation states, you know, when I was young, you know, there were perhaps 60 or 80 nation states. Now there are more than 200. You know. So the idea of the nation state disappear, I think, is a real fantasy. You know. But also we know that the borders don't disappear. They disappear for good, but they don't disappear for person. You know. Which means, yes, I think that there is. I don't want to elaborate, you know, on this because you know you. You cannot really interpret, you know, what is, you know, in the mind of all those who decided to immigrate, who decided, you know, to go in other countries, But it's perfectly clear, you know, but there is at the same time not only the fact that, you know, if you can reach Germany and if you can reach England, you know, if you are not blocked in France, you know, well, you can reach a country where you can of course earn better living. But also, I think there is the idea that yes, the world belongs to us all. You know? I think I was, for example, there were several films, you know, made by a French filmmaker, you know, which name is about the migrants, you know, precisely who are, you know, so in France, you know, in Calais, you know, just in front of the channel, you know, and all those people coming mostly either from Kurdistan, from Afghanistan, from Ethiopia, from Ghana, from both parts of the world, you know, and yes, what is striking, you know, in the when they speak, you know, is this kind of revendication of a kind of, let's say, of a right to travel, you know, of, of a right to travel throughout the world and to know the world as something that belongs to everybody. So I think you can think of it as also a way of reconfiguring the distribution of the space and who has the right to be in this space or not to be in that space. You know. Well, but at the same time, you know, I think it's not easy to elaborate too much on this, you know, because when you think of those people, you know, who died, in the Tyrrhenian Sea, you know, not much think that perhaps not a matter of philosophy.
Some order that the prerogative of the chair allowed me to ask the question.
Thank you. I'll just make this very brief. I was trying to understand your conception of leisure and its function in the production of gaps and distances, and I thought I would just focus it on one question, which a phrase that struck me that I had some difficulty in linking to the other moments that you used the term leisure, but that was the endlessness of leisure, and I wondered what you meant by the endlessness of leisure.
Oh yes, I constructed this talk, you know, as a part, you know, of a series of free talks, you know, which of course I gave one in Irvine, one in at UCLA, and all those talks, you know, for me, of course, but not for you, you know, were part of the same questioning, you know, about the relation between time, narration, and politics, but more precisely, you know, focusing on literature here or on politics, right? But what? Well, so basically, I was really referring, you know, in this kind of basic construction of the hierarchy of time, you know, while in the passage, you know, of Aristotle's Poetics, you know, politics, Aristotle's, and it's not his own theory; it's a kind of generalization division of times says that, well, there are two forms of inactivity, you know. Well, there is a pause, you know. When you are a worker, you know, you need a pause, you need a break between two efforts, you know. And there is leisure. And leisure, traditionally, was the fact precisely of not being submitted to the constraint of work, of not being submitted to the constraint, precisely to the division of work, then rest. You know. So leisure basically is the form of life of those who have time. You know. And of course, it's a very important concept. You know, and you must be reminded that, you know, school, the very word school comes from the Greek skole, which means leisure. With the idea precisely, you know, that the space and time of the school is a space of time, you know, at remove from the necessity, you know, from the necessity of practical life, etc. So this is in that sense that I use it, and because I think that, you know, those categories that are very very old, you know, for instance, the difference between active and passive human beings, you know, same time still reappear, you know, and still structure, you know, many narratives and many judgments. So the idea that there is always the idea, for instance, you know, that for instance, politics, for a very, very long time, politics has been reserved to people who were called men of leisure, you know, meaning, well, people who have time, you know, people who have time, and if you even think, you know, of the principles, you know, of the founding fathers of the United States, you know, there was the idea that politics had to be made by people who had time, you know, people who are not, you know, obliged to do all those degrading things that take your time, you know, hinder you from thinking, etc. So, it is a way, you know, it has been a very long struggle, and the struggle is not still ended, you know, about this partition of times.
Thank you. My question is a clarification question. Towards the end of your talk, you talked about these new struggles for justice, new emancipatory struggles, and that they take place in new spaces, the park, the street, instead of the factory, and also perhaps there are new temporalities to them, such as some of them are more ephemeral. But then you talked about that they are also the spaces where different times are being assembled. And I was wondering what you really had in mind, what you say different times are being assembled. And then for me, the big question is then, to what effect? What? How does it matter in terms of the times of which are being assembled in these new spaces and these new sites?
I was thinking of two things, you know. First, you know, that, you know, there are multiplicity, you know, of experiences of fragments of time, you know. But, well, that, you know, sent, you know, people to the streets and to the parks. You know. It was the first, you know, I would say, the idea that there are multiplicity of very different, you know, experiences of fragments of time, you know. But precisely, the question is how you think precisely when the end of the time, when the factory time, you know, was the dominant time, you know. And there is this global, this dominant analysis, you know, of so-called post-Fordism, you know, saying that now, you know, everybody is working on computers, you know, and there is no more division, you know, between the time of work and the time of leisure and so on. And I really think it's not the experience of time, you know, that we have now, you know. Because what is in stake, you know, is rather is, you know, well, this kind of fragmented time, you know, part time, you know, constant move from employment, constant, you know, specific form, you know, of division, you know, between two forms, between several forms of not only of work but of life time. And so, and what I said, you know, is, well, once, you know, people are gathered, you know, in the forms of occupation, you know, well, at the same time, what was at work, you know, in the street, you know, was also several ways of thinking the organization of time, you know, and of course, in the occupation, there was many occupations, you know, there was very simple fact, you know, of organizing, you know, so your daily life, you know, very prosaically, you know, but also the idea of constructing, you know, moments of gathering, moments of discussion, you know, forms of discussion, and also the idea, you know, that a movement based, you know, on this kind of practices is also a movement that must construct, you know, a specific agenda. You know. Specific agenda. Well, if you think of what happened, for instance, in Madrid, you know, the slogans of the indignators, you know, against, you know, their representatives, you know. Well, very precisely the idea that, you know, that this kind of movement is constructing another kind of political agenda, you know, not an agenda just of reaction, you know, of reaction against, you know, or in relation to the state agenda, you know, but an agenda when one tries, you know, to advance your own proposals, you know, your own idea of a kind of linkage, you know, of possibilities and so on, you know. And I was also thinking, you know, of all those forms, you know, of anticipation, you know, of forms of the future, but always that have reappeared, you know, around the recent movements. And thinking, for instance, in Greece, this idea of creating some kind of alternative social space, you know, with some forms of cooperatives, forms of alternative information, of education, and so on. So, well, which for me reminded, you know, something that was very important in the past, you know, the idea that an emancipatory movement is not only a movement but prepares emancipation, you know, but a movement that creates, you know, already, you know, forms of alternative forms of life. So I was also thinking of some forms of specific performance, you know, like the performance of the standing man, you know, in Istanbul. So the idea that there are some several forms of experience of time that gather people, you know, and that this gathering also produces, you know, several forms of reframing of time, you know, and one. Again, I think it is something that you can see, that you can perceive. It doesn't mean that you think that it is. Well, the new way of the future. We don't know what the new way of the future is. But my main point really was to insist, you know, perhaps on this idea when it is from the moment itself, you know, that from that a new form of time, you know, can be created. You know. And in a way, you know, instead of all those people, you know, who say, you know, that oppose a strategy to the strategic long time to the ephemeral, well, most of really, you know, even long-term political movements, you know, were created from moments, some days, some weeks, where a new kind of color of collective, you know, as gathered, you know, in the street, you know, in the place, etc. Last question.
Very quickly, because you explained so many times already, but just as a clarification, it seems to me that you're suggesting that out of the production of space and these multiplicities, there might be a stage for something, you're not saying larger, that's a little utopian, but you're suggesting that they're not simply scattered events, that there might be part of some larger process that could perhaps happen? Is that part of what you're suggesting? I'm not asking you to promise anything.
No. Thank you. Yes. No. I think you are correct. I think that there is a state of things which produces these forms, you know, well, these new forms of affirmation, you know, of collectives that try to think and act at remove, you know, from the dominant organization of time. And that's all that I say. And of course, it's something that we can just perceive, you know, and it is not really something they had invented. You know, just trying to think how it urges us perhaps to rethink the traditional opposition, for instance, the traditional opposition between, you know, the long term and the ephemeral.
Thank you.
Thank you.